sisters. Welcome to church. As we come before our Lord, may I invite you to please stand. The Lord be with you.
And also with
you. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus said, the first commandment is this: the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your hearts, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than this. Amen. Lord, have mercy upon us and write all these laws in our hearts. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly to keep God's commandments, to live in love and peace with all men. May I invite you to please sit as we reflect on the week that has passed and see if there's anything that displeases our Lord that we may come before him to confess. With a humble and contrite heart, let us say this confession prayer together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our fellow men, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen.
Receive now the words of absolution. The Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. Good morning. Shall we rise to praise the Lord? The first song is actually called Thank You, Lord, and there's just a very simple sign language that we can actually learn, right? So it goes like that. Thank you. Let's try together. Thank you, right, from your mouth. And Lord is, you form a L with your right hand and cross over from your shoulders. Lord. Okay, that's all. Right? So, thank you, Lord. All right. Thank you, Lord. Okay, and later on when we enter the chorus, you can just raise your hand in the air and because it's a lot of actions. So those of you who can continue to do actions, you can do so. Or if not, you can just raise your hands in the air. Okay, shall we praise the Lord together? Hallelujah. I come before you today, and there's just one thing that I want to say. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all you've given to me. For all the blessings that I cannot see. Let's thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. With a grateful heart, with a song of praise, with an outstretched arm, I will bless your name and thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. For all you've done in my life, you took my darkness and gave me your light. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. You took my sin and my shame. You took my sickness and healed all my pain. Thank you, Lord. Let's raise our hands to the Lord. With a grateful heart, with a song of praise, with an outstretched arm, I will bless your name. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Please be seated.
Today's scripture reading is taken from Matthew chapter 5, verse 8. Matthew chapter 5, verse 8. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. This is the word of the Lord.
Very good morning to everyone, and what a joy and blessing it is that we can come to worship the Lord together. May we pray. Lord, as we come before your word this morning, enable us to hear your voice afresh, that you inspire us anew. Lord, to follow you, to do your will, to serve your purposes, we ask that you have your way with us. Lord, and do a fresh work in our hearts to transform us for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Recently, Deborah and I paid a visit to a very dear friend. In fact, he's a retired bishop. And over the years, this friend had developed a hobby of painting. How many of you paint here? A few of you. Good. Great. Yeah. So you're so shy. well, his choice of paint is acrylic rather than watercolor, because those of you who know painting, apparently, if you make acrylic, you can rectify quite easily with acrylic, but with watercolor, it's a bit more, much more difficult. Did you know that? Okay, so you're not. That means you paint. And one thing that struck us was his ability to capture on canvas the feel and the character of the places where his landscapes were located. He's been to many, many places, Barcelona, Santorini, Malaysia, and all that. And for instance, when painting a pre-war shop house in Ipoh, not unlike those that we see around here, in Ipoh, the shop houses are not so well maintained like we have here. And so you'll find that the paint is peeling in some parts of the building. But nonetheless, he was able to capture the varying shades and color used and it to reflect the character of the place and the period of a bygone era that this building belonged to. He exhibited a deep understanding of not only the subject of his painting, but also demonstrated the skills he had with the tools to bring that about. And of course, the outcome was a delight and something to be appreciated and admired. In a sense, one may say he had mastery over his art. Certainly, the product was of far more worth than the paint and the canvas and the picture frame combined. Did you know that he actually painted Holy Trinity Church 10 years, more than 10 years ago, and the painting was auctioned? When we think of what God wants to do with us, even to transform and perfect us, in order that we may be useful to Him, we can rest assured that we are in very good hands. In fact, excellent hands. In fact, if we were to look at Ephesians 2 verse 10, it says, "For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." Hallelujah. Isn't that wonderful? That God is at work on our lives and in our lives in order to reveal His purposes to the world. And we are truly in the Master's hands. And we can rest assured that the outcome would be of far greater worth than what we are now. Amen? He knows what best to do, and what He will accomplish in us will be to His praise and glory. You know, Philippians 1 verse 6 reminds us too, and I'm sure of this, that He who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Christ Jesus. This reminds me of a t-shirt that a little child wore, yeah? And on the front it says, "Please be patient with me." Have you seen that one before? And at the back of the t-shirt it says, "God is not finished with me yet." Please be patient with me. God is not finished with me yet. And amazingly, that's who we are, isn't it? God is not done with us yet. Amen? And we can trust Him to do what He wants with us. Today, as we look at the sixth beatitude, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God," this is something which tells us very much about what God wants to do. In Psalm 24 verse 3, it says, the question is asked, "Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord? And who shall stand in His holy place?" And the reply in verse 4, "He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to what is false and does not swear deceitfully." In Psalm 51, verse 10, we read King David's prayer, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." Now this, my friends, I'd like to suggest, is very, very important if we truly want to see God. And what Jesus was basically pointing out was this very, very thing, that God expects us to be morally and spiritually pure in order that we may stand before His holy presence. In fact, in both these psalms, they are also psalms of King David. Yeah. In the course of my studying the Beatitudes, I got, you can say, a renewed excitement and interest in studying the Psalms of David. You do your psalms, do your psalms as well. And I would encourage you, if you read the Psalms of David, it will really, really inspire you. Because, you know, if we look at God's own assessment of David, He says, "There's no one that I find in Israel who's like David, because he is a man after my own heart." So if you want to be after God's heart, if you want to know God's heart, then I may encourage you, study the Psalms of David. Read and capture, try to capture in your hearts what He is saying, what He has been saying, and the things that matter to him and how he approached God. And you'll find that, you know, that is something that will be instructive and inspiring as well. Truly, friends, if we desire to be in God's presence and to behold his glory, our hearts need to be pure. As we look at this sixth beatitude, we will see that this is not, we'll look at this under 2 points. Firstly, we'll look at who the pure in heart are, who are the pure in heart, and secondly, what it means to see God. Yeah, what it means to see God. Yeah. First of all, who are the pure in heart? The Greek word for pure is katharos. And this word has a range of meanings, and it may mean to be, for instance, without blemish, without mix, or without alloy. Yeah? In short, it describes something that is unadulterated, pure milk. You know, when you look on the shelf, pure milk, you know, there's this 100% milk. It's not with additives and so on. It's untainted, it's uncontaminated, it's uncorrupted, unspoiled, and purge of every undesirable element. And that's what katharos means, pure. Yeah. It may refer to something that is physically uncontaminated or untainted, such as you would describe pure gold, pure silver, pure milk, pure water. Yeah. The other refers to something that is moral or spiritual, such as purity in thought and purity in heart, in our motives. In the what is called the Septuagint, which is the Old Testament in Greek, this word katharos was used 150 times. And they basically carry two meanings. Firstly, to refer to ceremonial purity. For instance, in reference to the food that they were allowed to eat, what we call, the Jewish will call kosher food, and animals that can be eaten. It is also used to refer to purity in relation to ceremonial washings or ritual laws, all of these actually having little or no moral content. It's just that they are prohibited from eating shellfish, okay? I mean, is there anything spiritual or moral about it? No. Yeah. And we find this meaning of katharos used 37 times in the book of Exodus and 34 times in the book of Leviticus. The other meaning of katharos in the Old Testament refers to spiritual or moral purity. And we see this, for instance, in Genesis chapter 20, verse 5 and 6, which carries the meaning of integrity. Somebody who is morally upright is a person of integrity. Yeah? Also in Psalm 24, verse 4, and Psalm 51, verse 10, which refers to someone who is spiritually pure, someone who is clean from sin. He has been cleansed from sin. In short, the first type of usage in katharos is purity in relation to ritual observances, ceremonies, and so on. The second type of usage is in relation to the matter of life and conduct and the state of one's mind and heart. Friends, insofar as our Lord Jesus is concerned, purity is an inward thing. It was a matter of the heart, of the mind, and the attitude of one's soul. A man can have, for instance, within his heart, thoughts of arrogance and pride, bitterness and hatred, unclean thoughts and desires. Now, from the viewpoint of the religious leaders of Jesus' day, so long as outward rituals were correctly observed, the man was considered pure. However, from our Lord's point of view, even if someone has done all that may be ceremonially correct with dedication and devotion, he may still be utterly impure because the thoughts of his heart were not pure. For instance, if somebody makes an offering to God, but in his heart there is unforgiveness or there's hatred or there's anger, then obviously what he has done in the eyes of everybody, oh, he's making an offering to the Lord. But you know what? From Jesus' point of view, that person is not pure. Such teaching may not have gone down well with Jesus' audience. Most would have equated zeal in religious observances and rituals as reflective of one who is morally or spiritually pure. Friends, keeping one's own heart pure and free from wrongful thoughts and desires was not something that they considered in those days. What can we learn from this? Well, clearly, for a start, the way we assess our own spiritual condition. Do we equate zealous participation in church or Christian activities as a measure of our spiritual state and well-being? Do we think that we are spiritually well if we do all that a good, committed Christian would dutifully do? For instance, we may read the Bible well enough, perhaps even do our daily offices. Those of you who are more traditional Anglicans, you understand it is encouraged for us to read the Bible, what is called using the daily office of morning prayer and evening prayer. Yeah. We may even use pious language. We may even carry ourselves in a respectable manner. We may even pay our tithes and offerings. We may even perform church duties devotedly and so on. In the eyes of Christ, we may yet not be spiritual. Friends, God cannot be deceived. He knows what is in our hearts. He is not as concerned about our outward performance as he is with our inner condition. What is going on in our hearts? Blessed are the pure in heart. And he invites God's people to enter and to embrace their purity. God is concerned about the conversion of our hearts and our ongoing transformation into Christ-likeness. Are there thoughts that are unworthy that we allow ourselves to be amused by privately, secretly, when nobody else is watching? Are there wrongful desires that we cherish? Do we secretly entertain worldly desires or lustful yearnings in our souls? Are we relishing in a sense of self-importance, self-display or pride each time we get acknowledged, commended or promoted? Friends, the purity that Jesus demands is not an external or ceremonial purity, but that of the heart. You know, Thomas Cranmer, the Archbishop of Canterbury for whom is attributed, the Book of Common Prayer. And if you understand his spirituality, and if you read and study Thomas Cranmer well enough, you will discover that his spirituality is a spirituality of the heart. Which is why it is not strange that if you read through his prayers, and in the Book of Common Prayer, for instance, you'll find that time and time again, the heart is always brought before the Lord. At the beginning of our service this morning, what did we pray? After Pastor James said, "The Lord be with you," you said, "What's wrong with you?" No, he didn't say that. He said, "The Lord be with you." And you say, "And also with you." And the next thing is an invitation to prayer. And that prayer is a prayer that is inspired and drawn from Thomas Cranmer. You remember that prayer? It says, "Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden." That is the prayer. Nothing is hidden from God's sight. And all the secrets of our hearts are laid bare before the Lord. You know, the heart is a very, very unpredictable thing. And in fact, the prophet Jeremiah pointed that out in Jeremiah 17, verse 9 to 10. The heart is deceitful above all things. Wow, think about it. And desperately sick. Some versions say wicked. Who can understand it? Can I ask you this morning, how many of you really know your heart? well? Anybody know your own heart well? Sometimes you say, okay, I believe I'm like that. Then one moment, next moment you find yourself, why am I thinking like that? Why am I feeling that way? Why am I entertaining that kind of thoughts? What's wrong with my heart? Don't see a cardiologist, see Jesus. Not talking about the physical, but the spiritual. The prophet Jeremiah tells us that. Who can understand the heart? But verse 10 is very assuring. Where God said, I, the Lord, search the heart and test the mind to give every man or every person according to his ways or her ways, according to the fruit of his or her deeds. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. For your heart is a wellspring of life. And Jesus, you remember, it's not what goes into a person that defiles the person, but what comes out of his heart. That is why we rightly and humbly and contritely pray each time we gather before the Lord, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden. The psalmist, King David, knew this very well. When he said in Psalm 139, 23 and 24, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. And see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. It's amazing. King David came before God. Search me, O Lord. Check me out. See if anything that's unworthy, unright, not right before you, point it out to me so that I may repent of them and lead me in your everlasting path. You see, King David knew that he could not hide anything from God. Anyway, it's futile, it's pointless. He also knew that God would treat the penitent and contrite with mercy and grace. And he does the same with us today. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. He's not out to point things out in order to condemn us. But in order that these things may be surfaced and removed out of our lives. Yeah, he searches us so that we may be cleaned up and be set back on the right track. Unlike what many people tend to do, King David did not run away from God. Whenever he's aware of wrongdoing, or whenever a wrongdoing has been pointed out to him, instead, he ran into God's arms. I surrender. You know, sometimes little children, when they know they have done wrong, right? What do? Some kids will run and hide, isn't it? And then when they know they've got nowhere to run, what do? They run and grab your leg, right? Have you experienced that before? They say, okay, you know what you've done, huh? Okay, daddy, sorry, daddy. I'm sorry, mommy, right? Am I right? Those of you who are parents, you understand what I'm talking about. And friends, this was what King David did. He ran into the arms of God because he knows that's the safest place to be, right? Friends, the Lord searches our hearts and examines the mind. Don't be afraid of that. Don't try to hide. It's pointless. God's desire is that he may surface the impurity and the contamination that is in us in order that these may be removed from our lives. So each time when we pray the prayer, you know, Sunday after Sunday, each time we pray Sunday after Sunday, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, we can rest assured the next line onwards, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts. Amen? By the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, so that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen? And what do God's people say? Thank you, Lord. Amen? So I did learn something this morning. Thanks, Marcus. But so who are the pure in heart? Well, this beatitude describes the blessedness of the person whose thoughts, whose affections, whose aspirations, whose desires, whose motives, and the like are unmixed, uncorrupted, untainted, genuine, and sincere. As the deer pants for the water, so my soul longs after you. It's a longing for God. It's a longing and yearning after God. If we realize what this beatitude is saying, it may well be actually the beatitude which is also the most demanding. Did you know that? Why is that? Because it requires strict and honest self-examination. If properly understood and embraced, it would lead us to self-denial and a dying to our own egos. And as we allow ourselves to die to our self-life, Christ will be increasingly seen in us. His character will emerge from within our hearts. His thoughts will increasingly become our thoughts. His ways, our ways. His will, our wills. Isn't that amazing? This leads me to my second point. What does it mean to see God? Titus 1, verse 15 to 16 says, to the pure, all things are pure. But to the defiled and unbelieving, nothing is pure. But both their minds and their consciences are defiled. They profess to know God, but they deny him by their works. They are detestable, disobedient, unfit for any good work. See, God wants to purify our hearts, purify our minds, purify us so that whenever we see things, we will begin to see things the way God sees things. Anything. And then, of course, there's a lot of these stand-up comics that people pay to watch, you know, who will make a joke out of everything and will mock everything. Do they have pure hearts? Do they have pure minds? There's something to think about. Conversely, the scripture tells us to the pure, all things are pure. And that person will be able to see the redemptive purpose and the good of what God is doing, even in the worst and most despicable of sinners. Isn't that wonderful? So when we look at somebody who has, you know, done something very, very terrible or very bad, there are two ways to look at that person. But the question we should ask is, how does God look at that person? That we're going to learn to look at the person the way God looks at that person. And God wants to redeem that person. God wants to reveal his grace and his mercy to that person. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that wonderful? Do you think that's wonderful? How do you want God to look at you? With eyes of love and grace and mercy, or with eyes of judgment and condemnation? Because none of us are righteous before God, and none of us can stand before God. We need his grace and mercy. Lord, we need your grace and mercy, like the song we sing. We do. And in the same manner that we have freely received, Jesus said, we also do freely give. If you are serving royalty or monarch, it would be a privilege for any servant to be always standing in the presence of the king, to be able to see his face, hear his voice, listen to his thoughts and wisdom. Remember the account of the Queen of Sheba when she visited King Solomon? And what did she say when she saw King Solomon and all the people who were with him? And she said, happy are your men. Happy are your servants who continually stand before you and hear your wisdom. And for the one who is serving the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, it is even a far greater privilege and blessing to be in his presence and to see him in his glory. How many of you want to see the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords? How many of you want to see God? It's a blessing. It's a blessing. It's a joy. In fact, such a privilege. In Exodus 33, verse 18, Moses requested of the Lord, "Lord, please show me your glory." However, he was only permitted to see the back of God's glory, the glimpse of it, because no living person will be permitted to see God and still live. Again, in Psalm 17, verse 15, King David said, "As for me, I shall behold your face in righteousness. When I awake, I shall be satisfied with your likeness." You know, what King David was saying was that his desire was to behold God's face in righteousness and to be satisfied when he awoke with the likeness of God. He wanted to see God so that he can be transformed to be more godly, to be more like him. In Psalm 41, verse 12, King David said, "But you have upheld me because of my integrity and set me in your presence forever." David was expressing his hope that because of his integrity, God would set him before his face forever. In Psalm 63, verse 2, and Psalm 140, verse 13, we see King David's greatest desire was not just to see the power and the glory of God, but to dwell in his presence eternally. His bliss was to be forever in the presence of God. Is this our desire? Is this your desire? Do you want to see God? To be in his presence? You know, many of us who have been involved in worship ministry, and there are times when we are worshiping God in such a way, to such an extent, that we experience God's presence so real that there is no desire for us to leave his presence. How many of you have experienced that before? Sometimes during church camps, you experience some of that stuff. Am I right? And you just don't want to leave God's presence because it's so wonderful. Yeah. It's not scary. It's wonderful. Yeah. It's only scary if we know there are things that we need to surrender or need to be dealt with. Yeah. Tomorrow is what many call what? Oh, you see. Only one. What about the rest? Many couples or would-be couples would relish the idea of being in the company of their significant other. Am I right? When it comes to the God whom we claim to love, do we have such longing? Do we yearn to be with him, even to be in his presence? Something to think about, not just today, but also tomorrow. Huh? Is the way of the Lord prepared in our lives? If so, would you let the Lord, through the power of the Holy Spirit, work in us? Friends, if we truly desire to have a deep intimacy of relationship with God so as to see him, are we prepared for what it will take? Will we let Christ have full right of way in our hearts? Is he allowed to deal with us as he sees fit? Our rights, even our wills, our self-wills, will have to be laid down. Are we ready to die to that? To die to selfish ambition? To die to our sense of self-importance? To die to our self-centeredness, our self-gratifying, self-seeking ways? Are we willing to be purged of every unworthy desire and ambition in our hearts? If so, we are on track. And the Lord will remove all the dross and all the impurity from our lives, and he will set us on track. Amen? He will lead us in the way everlasting. Another question needs also to be asked. Are we prepared to invest time with God? Are we willing to spend time with him in prayer, in waiting upon him, in reading and studying his word, in letting him speak to us? Will we allow the Holy Spirit to work not only in us, but also on us? Sometimes we like the idea that we want to feel the Holy Spirit's presence. Ah, we know he's in us. So we feel good. But there are things he wants to work on. Will we allow him to deal with those things? They're very uncomfortable at times. Will we let him reform us, to renew us, to refine us day by day? You know, such a work involves deep cleansing of our thought life, our emotions, our motives, our desires, and things that may be deeply buried and lie hidden even from our conscious awareness. If we are, then we are on track to experience the bliss of the pure in heart. And you'll be on track to see God increasingly clearly. And the marvelous thing is that in turn, Christ will also be increasingly seen in you. As we spend time, as we see God, as we get transformed, then his glory will be increasingly made manifest and revealed in and through us to the world. For we are his workmanship. Amen. Each and every one of our lives is a masterpiece in the making, in God's hands. And what will be revealed will truly show his glory. Hallelujah. As I conclude, may I share with you a story. Just over 9 years ago, Deborah and I were on our flight back from our honeymoon in Israel. And while transiting in Dubai, we were pleasantly surprised when we were told that we had been upgraded to business class. How many of you experienced that before? This was very welcome because we were extremely sleepy and tired from the traveling. And it was also almost 3 o'clock in the morning when we boarded. And then, of course, when we were awakened after a good rest for breakfast, some hours later, we were naturally grateful to the Lord for blessing us with such an unexpected comfort. And while breakfast was served, a stewardess noticed Deborah reading her Bible. Maybe this was not something that they do. Maybe this lady saw something in Deborah and proceeded to strike up a conversation with her. And in a brief exchange, Deborah learned that she was from Kenya and was living in Dubai because of her work. And she was a Christian and was raised in a Christian home. However, for various reasons, she had not been going to church. And her name was Purity. Purity. And as we prayed, Deborah was prompted by the Lord to pass her a verse of scripture as we disembarked. You can guess what scripture that was. Matthew 5, verse 8. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Deborah reminded the stewardess that she was given that good name for a reason and encouraged her to think about it and to also make the effort to be in fellowship with other Christians, even in Dubai. Friends, we may not know what God will do. We may not know how he will do something to bring about the fullness of his will in each of our lives or in the lives of those around us. They may be people we know. They may even be total strangers. Nevertheless, we are given the opportunity to sow, to water, to reap. Let us never cease to allow God to use us in the manner he sees fit. While in our hearts, Deborah and I occasionally wonder what has become of Purity and others like her too that we have encountered. That is not actually important. What is important is that the Lord, who is at work in us and through us for his praise and glory, he is the one who began the good work. He will bring it to completion. What we ought to do is to continue to sow and to water. And if there's the opportunity to reap, praise and glory be to God too. I'm aware that some of you may be thinking of ways to witness and share the gospel with others despite prevailing social distancing restrictions. I didn't want to use the term safe distancing because any encounter with Jesus is not safe. But of course, we have our social distancing restrictions. But my prayer is that the Lord will open ways for you and I to reveal himself through us creatively and effectively also. I know folks in the net ministry are looking at some of these things especially. For each of us, I pray that Christ may be formed in us. Even Christ in us, the hope of glory. Take a quick look at each other. Can you turn to the person next to you? And can you just say a brief prayer in your heart? Lord, I bless my friend. I bless this person that he or she may be filled and transformed into Christ-likeness so that Christ may be seen in him or her. May God's glory be increasingly seen in our lives so that many will be led to see him, turn to him, and be saved. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God, and in turn, others will see Christ in us, the hope of glory. Shall we pray? Lord, thank you for the good work that you've begun in each of our lives. Lord, as you continue to transform us more and more into Christ-likeness, as you continue to change us, help us, Lord, to take time to be with you each day. Lord, truly as we love you, enable and inspire us, Lord, to love you even more. And how that love will translate itself into time spent with you, to see your face, to seek you, to wait upon you, to hear your voice, so that we may be transformed more and more into Christ-likeness. And how that in turn, Lord, will be used by you to reveal your glory to the world. For we are your workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, let's rise for the response song. May we invite the Holy Spirit to search our hearts, and may the word of the Lord search deeply and to speak to our hearts so that we may see him. Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word. Take your truth, plant it deep in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness, that the light of Christ might be seen today in our acts of love and our deeds of faith. Speak, O Lord, and fulfill in us all your purposes for your glory. Can never fail.
truth prevail over unbelief. Speak, O Lord, and renew our minds. Help us grasp the heights of your plans for us. Truths unchanged from the dawn of time that will echo down through eternity, and by grace we'll stand on your promises, and by faith we'll walk as you walk with us. Speak, O Lord, till your church is built and the earth is filled with your glory, and by grace we'll stand on your promises, and by faith we'll walk as you walk with us. Speak, O Lord, till your church is built and the earth is filled with your glory.
Remain standing.
Brothers and sisters, let us declare our faith with the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of sins, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated for the intercession.
Sometimes when we look at the world, we look at COVID, at sickness, and all our situations, we feel very helpless and useless. So, my brothers and sisters, let us now turn to God together. Let's turn to our great God and pray. Let's read the collect for today together. Eternal God, whose Son, Jesus Christ, is for all mankind the way, the truth, and the life, grant us to walk in his way, to rejoice in his truth, and to share his risen life, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let's continue to pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you that we can gather like this, in person and online, to worship you, to listen to your word, and to be encouraged in our hearts. We thank you for the freedom and the technology that we can enjoy in Singapore, so that wherever we are, we can continue to fellowship as Christians. Right now, we pray for those around the world, our brothers and sisters in various countries who do not enjoy the freedoms that we do. We pray for those who are suffering and who are tortured because they are Christians. We pray for those where we pray for families where children of Christians have been abducted and forced to undergo corrective training. We pray, Lord, that you will protect our brothers and sisters, that you will strengthen, encourage, and protect them when they suffer harassment, violence, imprisonment, and even the grief of death. We pray that you will keep their eyes on you and help them to remember the hope of heaven. We pray that you give them eyes of faith so that they can continue to be hopeful. We also pray for those who bully them. We pray that those who persecute Christians will have a turn of heart. In your goodness and in your great mercy, help those who do not know you to experience Christ the way Paul did, and help them to have a turn of heart so that they will not live against Christ but come to enjoy the salvation that Jesus gives. We also pray for our own situation in Singapore. As we look forward to the budget being delivered this year, we pray for those in Parliament, and we pray for our Finance Minister. We pray for wisdom from you so that they can make plans that will grow Singapore locally and internationally. We pray for a budget that is wise and kind to cater to the varying needs of all the different groups in our population. Lord, we also pray for our own diocese. We pray for our Bishop Titus Chung. Lord, please give him wisdom and give him a great love to shepherd the flock. As he leads his team of clergy, give him the good organization, the ability to teach, to admonish, and to encourage, and to plan. We pray for churches in Singapore to have a greater compassion in pastoral care, and care for, especially for members and non-members who have been adversely affected by the pandemic and all its effect. May the generosity and kindness that we show and the seeds of the gospel that we sow bear fruit so that God's kingdom can continue to advance. Lord, we also look out of Singapore to pray for our deanery countries, Thailand, Laos, Nepal, Cambodia, Vietnam, and Indonesia. May our churches and our community services be resilient and strong and courageous to reach out and help the needy and boldly share the gospel in the power of the Holy Spirit. Help us all, Lord, to bear in mind the great commandment and fulfill the great commission. Help us to love God and love one another and make disciples of all nations. Lord, at Holy Trinity, we want to especially pray for the children's the Christian education program, Parenting Young Children, which is going to begin today. We praise and thank you for all who have signed up. We thank you for the children that you have blessed each of these couples with. We thank you for the children that you have blessed our church with. And we pray that as these parents come together to learn about parenting their young children and to learn from one another, we pray for your anointing on the Sunday school call group as they facilitate each group. Lord, we pray that the discussions will be fruitful and helpful. We pray that the joy of the Lord will fill the facilitators and radiate through them. Lord, may you guide the hearts of parents so that we can guide our young children. And we pray that we thank you for these children who've been entrusted to our care, and we pray that we will grow them well to know God, to love God. Brothers and sisters, let us now think about the people whom we know, who may be suffering, who may be ill or grieving, and let's spend a moment to pray and commit them to God. Lord, in going about our daily lives, there are times of helplessness. Some of us may be ill and suffering from sickness. Some of us may be lonely, and some of us may be just going through a really bad patch. In all these things, when we feel out of control, Lord, we look to you, our great God. Strengthen our hearts to know that because of Jesus, we are neither hopeless nor helpless. That in Christ, we are full of hope, because Jesus has saved us. Help us as we go about our week to remember that we are very loved. Help us to look to you. All these we ask and pray in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Okay, yeah, some announcements. Sorry. No sound.
Yeah, there's sound. Okay, I'll just dangle it here then.
Okay, just very quickly, some announcements for all of us. The first thing, I'd like to welcome all of us. Among us, anybody who is new for the first time that you are here? Anyone? No? Okay. Nonetheless, welcome. Okay, they asked me to use this. You cut this wireless. Okay. Yeah, sorry. Okay, nonetheless, a warm welcome to all of us back to church. And for those who join us online, we want to welcome you back to church next week too. Okay, the first that you see here is a baptism class we have opened for registration. Those who are seeking to be baptized or even your child to be baptized, please register with myself, or Reverend Mok, or call the office to register. So classes will be conducted on the 20th of March, right through to the 10th of April on Sundays. So it will be at 1:30 p.m. Okay, so the baptism itself, baptism day, is on the 17th of April. Okay, do remember that. Next slide. Okay, our brother Sunny Lo has gone home to be with the Lord. So let us spend this moment and time to remember him and also to pray for the family. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you are the creator and preserver of life. We thank you for the gift of life. Thank you for our late brother Sunny's life in Christ and for loving his family. We humbly ask for your peace and comfort upon the family. May they be encouraged in the hope that when our Lord Jesus Christ comes again, we will once again meet and be with the Lord forever. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Do keep the family in prayer. Okay. Yeah. Next. Tithes and offering, okay, we want to encourage members continue to give your tithes and offering through electronic means. Let us now prepare our hearts for the Holy Communion.
King of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord.